Hello everyone, this is Dr. Jojo Kottoor, a respiratory dentist and endodontist from India. Today, we will be learning about dentine bonding agents, or I would say we try to understand the components in dentine bonding agents. The flowchart of the presentation will be like acid etching, primer, solvents, adhesive, bonding agents and enamel, bonding agents and dentine. Before going into the presentation, let's discuss very briefly about our substrate. So you need to get predictable bonding with the enamel and to the dentine. Enamel primarily composed of inorganic substance, that is hydroxyapatite crystals, so obviously it have less water. On the contrary, dentine have high water content because it is primarily composed of organic substance, basically the collagen. And you know, dentine have a lot of dentinal tubules, and dentinal tubules have water inside. So from this, logically we can assume that any type of bonding will be predictable to enamel because enamel have less water. And it is really technique sensitive to dentine because it has water inside. So it is like placing gum onto a moist substance or substrate. It is very difficult to achieve predictable bonding if you have moisture. So that's a challenge in bonding to dentine, whereas bonding to enamel is not that challenging because it doesn't have much water. We should also understand the relationship of the water and density of dentinal tubules. So obviously you have more tubules, there'll be more water. So superficial dentine have less dentinal tubules than deeper dentine. So what's the clinical significance of it? So bonding will be more predictable on superficial dentine because it have less tubules, so obviously less water. Whereas bonding to deeper dentine is little challenging because it have more tubules, definitely it have more water. This is the SCM image of the dentine. You can see the intratubular or pedicubular dentine and the intertubular dentine. So let's start with the first step, that is the acid etching. You know, it is done with phosphoric acid, concentration between 35 to 37%. Now, the etchant's objective is different on enamel and dentine. So let's discuss about enamel first. So towards enamel, the etchant obviously removes the smear layer, which is produced because of the cavity preparation. It makes the surface irregular by etching the enamel roads, and obviously it increases the surface energy, the surface free energy. So when the surface free energy is increased, the addition is improved. The objectives of dentine is quite similar, but there is a slight variation. Instead of etching the enamel roads, it exposes the collagen. That means it removes the hydroxyapatite crystals on the dentine, and what is remaining is the collagen. So it exposes the collagen. Obviously, it increases surface free energy, and it exposes the intertubular and peritubular dentine. You know, dentine also will be covered with the smear layer. So once the smear layer is removed, and there is superficial removal of hydroxyapatite crystals, there is exposure of inter and peritubular dentine. So these are the objectives of the acid etching. As I mentioned, it differs on enamel and dentine. So this is the magnified view of an enamel road. You can see here that the enamel road have a side. It's like a road. So you can see this is the sites of enamel roads and this is the end of enamel road. Okay, so this have a major clinical significance. And this sometimes we used to call a type of etching called end-on etching. So many used to wonder that what do you mean by this end-on etching? So in order to understand what is end-on etching, first let's discuss the etching pattern of the etchant on the enamel roads. So the roads etched on the ends, that means when you put an etchant here, that is on the top of the tooth, basically the roads ends are exposed towards the top and the etchant penetrate deeper there. That is deeper penetration of the etchant towards the ends. And when it comes to the sides here, when you place the etchant towards the sides of the enamel roads, there will be very shallow penetration of the etchant. It doesn't penetrate much. Okay. So it also have a very high clinical significance in our practice. What is that? So you have a class 1 cavity here. You can see a class 1 cavity which I had prepared here. And you can appreciate the enamel roads here. And when you place the etchant, you can see the etchant, we will place it here and here. The etching that is happening here is called the end-on etching because this is the end of the enamel roads. Whereas inside the cavity, the etching is toward the sides of the enamel roads. And I hope you understood the clinical significance here. Because towards the side, the etchant penetration is less than towards the end. So obviously when the penetration of etchant is less, the penetration of the resin, that is the bonding agent also, will be less towards the sides than the end. And that is rationally why we basically do the beveling. It is more pronounced in David Clark preparation, wherein he adequate an infinity bevel like this, here like this. Okay, so I can draw that for you. So David Clark adducate a bevel like this here. So what happens when you bevel like this is that, you know, the ends of the enamel roads are exposed more. So you get better end-on etching, better penetration of the resin, and better bonding. So that's the rationale of end-on etching. Okay. So let's scrub it off. Now let's move on to the dentine. And this is a SEM image of dentine after the cavity preparation. You can see the dentine surface is completely covered with smear layer. You can also appreciate the smear plug into the dentine tubules. This is what happens after the etching. You can appreciate complete removal of the smear layer and the smear plug from the peritubular dentine and intertubular dentine, exposing the collagen fibers inside the tubules and between the tubules. I will show you an exaggerated image of this picture. And this is the exaggerated image. You can even more appreciate the exposed collagen towards the peritubular and intertubular dentine. And you know how much that the etchant penetrates into the dentine when you etch for 15 seconds? Literature had shown that the etchant penetrates 7.5 micrometer into the dentine. What does that mean? It simply means that it removes 7.5 microns of hydroxyapatite crystals and exposing the collagen like a spaghetti. And you can see underlying you have the unaffected dentine. Now what is the clinical significance of this? Let me try to explain that with this systematic diagram. Here I try to draw the dentine systematically. Here you can see the dentine tubules. What you see as green fiber represents the collagen, and the yellow round crystals is obviously the hydroxyapatite. So this is the basic composition of dentine. Now what will happen when you etch for a longer time thinking that you get better bone strength? So what basically happened when you etch for a more time, maybe more than 15 seconds, is that the etchant penetrates greater than 7.5 micrometer and it removes the hydroxyapatite crystals probably to 10 microns or more. Now what happens here is when you place the bonding agent or when you apply the bonding agent onto the etched dentine, the bonding agent doesn't have the ability to penetrate 10 micrometer. So it for maximum it penetrates 5 to 7 micrometer, and you will get a gap between the hybrid layer and the underlying tooth structure. Now, what do you mean by hybrid layer? Hybrid layer is a combination of resin. Resin comes from the bonding agent and the collagen. So this combination, that is, once the dentine bonding agent is penetrated into the exposed collagen, this together we call it as a hybrid layer. Okay, so when you etch for a longer time, there is obviously a gap between the hybrid layer and the underlying tooth structure. And this gap is filled with dentine fluid, and there will be fluid movement which create post-operative sensitivity. It's a primary reason for post-operative sensitivity. Secondly, it will affect the longevity of the bonding because you have fluid movement here and there will be bond degradation over time. So this is something that we all should keep in mind when you apply etchant towards the dentine. Let's discuss now how to apply the etchant. Obviously, it should be applied with an applicator, but we should know that you have two types of the applicator. One is called the micro applicator and the other is called a micro brush. So micro applicator should be used when you use the etchant towards any cavities, primarily for restorative purpose. Whereas micro brush should be used when you want to put the etchant inside the root canal. For example, is a pore space. After pore space preparation, if you want to etch the pore space, you need to use the micro brush. What type of etchant you should use? We basically have two types of etchant. One is a gel form, the other is the liquid form. So where should we use the gel form? For all restorative procedures, we should use the gel form because we want the etchant to stay. We don't want it to ooze out, right? So we want the etchant to stay there where we had placed. So basically for all restorative procedure we use the gel form. And where should we use the liquid form? Liquid form should be used inside the pore space because we want the etchant to flow, because otherwise you can't expect the etchant to go all the way inside the pore space. So obviously you should use a liquid etchant if at all you're planning to etch the pore space. What about the etching time? Etching time differs for enamel and dentine, obviously. For enamel, I would say it will be between 15 to 30 seconds. Because even if you etch more, nothing is going to happen for enamel. But in a clinical perspective, there's no point in etching the enamel for more than 30 seconds. But there is a difference for uncut enamel and primary tooth. You need to etch more. And literature says you need to etch at least 1 minute if you're dealing with an uncut enamel. What do you mean by uncut enamel? For example, you want to place a veneer on a peg lateral. Peg lateral, you don't need any preparation. So obviously you are etching on an uncut enamel. Another example is you are trying to close a midline diastema. You don't need to prepare the tooth there. So you are again dealing with an uncut enamel. So I highly recommend to etch more than 30 seconds, preferably 1 minute when you're dealing with uncut enamel, or probably you are planning to etch a primary tooth. What about dentine? Dentine ideally doesn't need much etching, because when you etch more, things are complicated. So I would highly recommend to stick on the etching towards dentine for 5 seconds if possible. What about the rinsing time? Rinsing time is also very important when you're dealing with the bonding. You know why? Basically, you have two types of etchants, as we had discussed previously. You have the gel type etchant and the liquid type etchant. And gel type etchant is obviously what we use for restorative procedures, because we want the gel to stay inside the cavity, or probably to the area that we had specifically placed. So manufacturers, what they do is they add something called silica to make the gel form. So this silica generally interfere with the bonding. So we want the silica to be removed completely before you apply the bonding agent. So in order to achieve that, you need to rinse the etched tooth surface at least for 10 to 15 seconds. 10 to 15 seconds minimum if you're using a gel type of etchant, in order to remove the silica completely. Otherwise, you have compromised bonding. But when you're using a liquid etchant, which is highly unlikely when you're doing restorative procedures, probably you can reduce the rinsing time to 5 to 10. Before concluding about the etchants, let's discuss about the various terminologies that is being used in relation to etching procedure, starting with etch and rinse. Etch and rinse simply means you have an initial etching step followed by a compulsory rinsing step. Then you apply the bonding agent. Total etch means you etch the enamel and dentine together and then you apply the bonding agent. So if you ask me, etch and rinse and total etch is almost the same. The terminology differs. How about self-etching? Self-etching means we basically use an acidic monomer within the bonding agent. Classic examples are 6th and 7th generation bonding system. Obviously, we can classify universal bonding agent is also as a self-etching system. How about selective etching? So you know the drawback of using the phosphoric acid on dentine. Dentine is very sensitive to phosphoric acid. So what researchers had advocated is you use the phosphoric acid only to enamel and use some sort of mild etchant monomer, acidic monomers towards the dentine. So that's how the selective etching had come, wherein you etch the enamel only with phosphoric acid and you etch the dentine with a milder monomer or acidic monomers, which are commonly seen towards the 6th, 7th and universal bonding systems. The next component of bonding agent is a primer. So now you know bonding to enamel is easy and bonding to dentine is challenging, because dentine have moisture from the dentinal tubules. So obviously, where should the primer function? The answer is towards the dentine. We don't need the help of primer to achieve bonding towards enamel, because enamel doesn't have water. So that is why primers are called adhesion promoting agent. Primer directly don't help in adhesion. Instead, it indirectly transform the moist dentine surface in a peculiar manner, such a way that the subsequent agent, which is adhesive, can bond predictably to the dentine surface. So let's understand what primers are and how it functions. Primers are basically HEMA. If you take the primer which was used in 1990s and the primer which is used in the current bonding agents, it is still almost the same. Majority of the manufacturers use HEMA as a primer because it have a beautiful characteristic called amphiphilic property. What do you mean by amphiphilic property? It basically, the HEMA or the hydroxyethyl methacrylate have two functional groups. That means it have two arms. The first functional group is a methyl group and it is hydrophobic. The second functional group is a hydroxyethyl group, which is hydrophilic. This hydrophilic part, this part, will bond to the dentine, and the hydrophobic part will be projected outside, and which bonds to the subsequent layer, and that is the adhesive that comes after the primer. So that is why it is called an adhesion promoting agent, wherein when you apply the primer, the hydrophilic group will bond to the moist dentine, and the hydrophobic part functional group will be projected out to receive and bond with the next layer, that is the adhesive. Now don't think the primer can just do the job like this without any help. Primer requires help from another agent called solvents, which is also a part of the primer. So solvents is also being incorporated in majority, or I would say almost all, bonding systems in the dental market. Now what the solvent does is it displaces the water, or excess water I would say in specific, from the dentine surface, and this will indirectly help the hydrophilic part of the HEMA to bond predictably to the dentine surface. And manufacturers use variety of solvents in order to achieve these goals, which include acetone, ethanol, water, or a combination of these. Now there are other solvents which is being used in various other bonding systems like butanol, isopropyl alcohol, and all. But majority of the manufacturer generally use any of these combination. So we learned that the solvents helps in achieving predictable bonding of the HEMA to the dentine. Now once this job is done, we don't want the solvents to stay there. We want it to be removed. And that is why we generally say we need to air dry the bonding agent or the primer once it is being applied. The rationale of air drying is to remove the solvents. If the solvents is kept inside the bonding agent, it actually will interfere with polymerization and bond strength. So what is the clinical significance of knowing which solvent is there in our bonding system? For example, if you have acetone as a solvent in the bonding agent that we use in our dental office, we have to understand that it have the highest evaporation rate. So it requires the shortest drying time. I would say less than 5 seconds. We should not over dry the bonding agent if you're having acetone. If you have ethanol, it evaporates slowly, so you need to have a moderate drying time. I would say between 5 to 10 seconds. But if you have water or a combination of water and ethanol, it evaporates very slowly. So it requires the longest drying time. And majority of the self-etching systems, including the universal bonding agents, have water as one of the solvents. So obviously you need to air dry it for more than 10 seconds. That is the importance of solvents. And you also learned why it have to be removed after it serve its function. The next component of bonding agent is the adhesive or the pure bond. Now the pure bond basically have bisGMA as a monomer. It also have the UDMA and TECDMA, which is primarily used to control the viscosity. So we have a dentine substrate which is being modified with the help of primer. The primer have a hydrophilic and hydrophobic part. The hydrophilic part bonds to the dentine. The hydrophobic part is projecting outside to receive the bisGMA because it is hydrophobic. So the hydrophobic bisGMA bonds to the hydrophobic part of the primer. And when you light cure it, it copolymerizes. That means the primer and adhesive polymerizes together and becomes one single unit. Before going into the bonding principle, that is the last part of the presentation, we should be aware about the monomers that is being used in the current bonding agents. We already know two monomers. Number one is the HEMA, which is a monomer used in the primer. The second is the bisGMA, a monomer used in the pure bond along with UDMA and TECDMA. We also have a third type of monomer, which is basically a phosphate or carboxylate monomer. This is getting more attention now because these monomers have the ability to bond chemically to hydroxyapatite crystals and also to the collagen. Isn't that beautiful? Because till this time, till we started using the phosphate and carboxylate monomer, we only had two monomers, that is the HEMA and bisGMA, which doesn't have any chemical bonding to the hydroxyapatite and the collagen. The phosphate and carboxylate monomer have that property, and this is commonly being used in majority of the universal bonding agents that is right now available in the tender market. Let's move on to the last part of the presentation, that is how the bonding is achieved to enamel and dentine. You know, bonding to enamel is very easy and predictable because you already had created microporosities on the enamel rods. And we also understood that these porosities are effective towards the end of the enamel rods than towards the sides of the enamel rods. So when the resin that we apply on top in the form of a bonding agent penetrates into these irregularities, penetration, we call it as macrotacks and microtacks. Macrotacks is formed between enamel prism peripheries. That is, this is one prism, this is another prism, this is another one. So between these prisms, towards the periphery, macrotacks are formed, and towards the core of the enamel prism, microtacks are formed. So microtacks is actually helping in better bonding. That is a type of chemical bonding is that what happens with the enamel. Now when it comes to the bonding to dentine, it is slightly complicated. So we already had learned about hybrid layer. What is hybrid layer? You have a hydroxyapatite depleted area here. There's a lot of collagen there, and when you apply the bonding agent will penetrate all the way to the hydroxyapatite depleted area. And when we cure it, this hydroxyapatite depleted area will be replaced with the resin. So you have the resin and the collagen, and together this particular area we call it as hybrid layer or resin dentine interdiffusion zone. And this is a primary mechanism of bonding to dentine. The second way in which bonding to dentine is achieved is with the help of resin tacks. We also learned during the previous slide that when you etch the dentine, the peritubular and intertubular dentine is being exposed. So obviously when you apply the bonding agent will penetrate into the exposed dentinotubules at least to maybe 4 or 5 micrometer, and it also produces a tack, and these are called the resin tack. So the second way in which the bonding is achieved with dentine is with the help of resin tack. The third way of bonding to dentine is only achieved when we use a phosphate and carboxylate monomer. I told you these monomers have the ability to achieve chemical bonding, and these monomers will bond chemically to the hydroxyapatite crystals. In addition, these monomers will bond to the collagen peptide also. So this is the third and the fourth version of bonding of dentine can only be achieved when we use a phosphate and carboxylate monomer, and we will achieve bonding to collagen and also to the hydroxyapatite that is being remaining onto the acid-etched dentine. So to summarize about dentine bonding, how it is achieved, or the overall bonding, how it is achieved, it is a combination of micro-mechanical-chemical bonding. Why it is called so? It is because when it comes to enamel, the bonding is primarily by macro tacks and micro tacks. But when it comes to dentine, the bonding is combined with the help of hybrid layer, resin tacks, and chemical bonding and hydrogen bonding with hydroxyapatite and the collagen peptide, which is specifically achieved when we use the phosphate and carboxylate monomers. So this is how we achieve predictable bonding to enamel and dentine. Thank you for your patient listening. I have made it as simple as possible for you to really understand the components of bonding agent. If you have any doubts, you can give a comment. I'll be happy to answer that. And please do like the video. The moment I get 100 likes, I will definitely upload another part of bonding, probably something related to auxin inhibitor layer or generations of bonding agent. I can record it for you. Thank you. Bye.